I'm so excited to have you back here on Lily High on Life. And today we really do have a very extraordinary guest. I'd like to welcome the Member of Parliament for Caulfield, David Southwick. David, welcome.
Thank you, Lily. And what a great introduction that was of your regular show. It all starts with attitude, and that's something that I've always believed in. And you can change anything if you have the right attitude.
Absolutely. Now, one of the reasons, or one of the many reasons that I wanted to have you on the show, is because you and your wife, Hayley, do so much every day. Your day starts really early, very obviously, the two of you. And Facebook is filled with all the things that you do that should be a month's worth, but it's actually just a day's worth at a time. So I wanted to talk to you and Hayley eventually. And what is it? How do you get through that day? And no matter when I see you, because I've seen you late at night, I've come across you early in the morning, you're always smiling, you never complain, you're always bright. Tell me, how do you do it every day?
Well, I don't always feel like everything's going my way, particularly in politics, but my day starts at about 5 a.m. every morning, and I get alerts come through on my phone of the media of the day, and to Hayley's disappointment that kind of gets her awake as well. And I go off and start checking everything and do my media radio stuff that I have to do first thing in the morning, and that tends to set the day in terms of what might happen with my job. And then I go about whatever the day may bring. And the great thing about what I do now is that every day is a different day. And it's always really, really exciting. It's always learning, because I love to learn. I love to learn new things. And politics does that. You know, one day you're the shadow spokesperson for energy, and the next minute, you know, you're talking about police and prisons. So it's very diverse. But so it gives you that flexibility, and of course, you know, having a great soulmate like Hayley to be there along with me to share one another's journey is just so important.
Because she, in a completely different context, is just as busy as you are, separate to that,
yeah,
as well as the kids. So it's go, go, go. So my point also is that if you're a celebrity, people drive you around and then you do your, you know, hello here, hello there, and you do a whole lot of stuff. But you're not, I mean, you are a celebrity.
No,
but
I'm not a celebrity.
Really. But my question to you is, you don't just show up and do what you need to do. Part of your job in doing and showing up is actually following up and everything else. How do you partly manage it on a daily basis, but also get it right in your head that you're able to cope with so many different things?
So one of my biggest weaknesses is to be able to say no. So I'm not very good at saying no, and I love
to take on
things. So projects, I love projects. But I also believe that when you turn up, you just don't show up, but you get involved. You roll up your sleeves and you get involved. And that's something that was taught by my grandmother, my father. It's just instilled in me in my life. It's the Southwick way. We get involved and we rattle a tin and we raise money for charity. We just don't go and cut a ribbon. And so I've always been very, very focused around doing that in everything that I do. And I suppose some of that takes a bit of time. I mean, particularly when you're juggling a whole lot of things, and as well family. I think one of the things that's been very lucky, particularly in this current job that I do, and it's been coming up to 10 years next year, so in 2020, 10 years of being a Member of Parliament. But the thing about it is, when I first started, I had a long discussion with Hayley, because I said I was never going to do it without her 100% support, because I felt that it had to be a team effort, not an individual thing. And I'm lucky because Hayley does absolutely get involved in sharing a lot of the things that I do, and I do in a lot of the things that she does, but also with the kids as well. So unfortunately, because of our kids being immersed in this, particularly my son that's about to turn 18, he is a political animal. He loves politics even more than I. And so, you know, he and I have really robust discussions, and I absolutely would not be surprised if he followed in my footsteps. And as much as I'd like him to try other things, he absolutely has found, you know, a passion that he really loves.
And you actually followed in your father's footsteps, who he was also in politics and a council member? And
yeah, so my dad absolutely taught me. He was a councillor. He was out in Werribee. And what I loved about my upbringing is I was a Mount Scopus boy that, you know, went to school, had a lot of Jewish friends. But on weekends, my dad had a factory out in the western suburbs, and I would go out in his factory, work with him. If he had a community function to attend at the age of 7, 8, 9, 10, I was with him. One of the biggest, fondest recollections was we came around to Christmas time, and Dad was doing his usual Santa Claus for the local childcare centres. And I was out there with him, and he said, "Son," and I wouldn't have been any older than 10, he said, "Son, I've double booked myself. Get that bag out there. There's a Santa suit. Put it on, and you're going to be Santa in this other childcare centre." Now,
how awesome is that?
Jewish boy
for a 10-year-old?
From Mount Scopus, wouldn't know jingle bells. I know it now, and and I had to, if you like, play Santa at a childcare centre, and that was brilliant because I got to kind of be immersed in different worlds, and I think that's really, really important that we expose our children to a whole range of different things. I'm a strong advocate within our community that we also spend time outside our community, because to advocate against, you know, anti-Semitism, to hate, to, you know, to, for people to understand what the Jewish community is about, they've got to meet Jews, they've got to understand us, they've got to, you know, come to our homes, and really, really get us. And if you like, that's one of the proud things that I feel, again, being a member of Parliament, is that I've taken a lot of my colleagues on this journey, a physical journey, whether it be to Israel or to home for a Shabbat, or just even chats about being Jewish, and, you know, I feel really proud that, you know, my colleagues get me, and they get our religion, and they get Israel. And for me, that's probably one of the single biggest achievements, particularly in this job, is that I've been able to be a really strong advocate and someone very passionate to be able to educate others that haven't had the quite understanding about our community and about Israel.
And that is so, so very, very important, because you need that personal one-on-one. David, tell me a little bit about your relationship with your father, because obviously it was very, very close. It was one where you did follow in his footsteps, and you've instilled that in your son, it looks like. Tell me about...
And my daughter too, absolutely. So, look, we had the closest of relationships. We really did. I was the oldest child, one of three. And Dad was a passionate community person. He was into everything. He was a really, really hard worker. One of the things I remember a lot is Dad, you know, spent a lot of time where he wasn't home. Mum really brought us up most nights. But on a weekend, if it was going to his factory or then going afterwards to the football or any of those sort of things, that's something Dad and I would do. We would share so much together. And he taught me the values of hard work. He taught me, you know, the fact that, you know, you've got to actually really fight for something that you believe in. And the best thing about it is, no matter what we did, and I think this is one of the things that Hayley do with our kids, is no matter what our kids do, you know, even if they're, you know, first to finishing a packet of chips, you know, we celebrate that and say how good that they've been able to actually being able to achieve whatever it is. We celebrate everything with our kids. We do that a lot on Facebook, and a lot of people say, "Oh, isn't it great that you talk about your kids?" Because we're proud of them. And I think you have to really give the kids confidence to go on. And that's, my parents were proud of everything that we did, absolutely everything we did. They never really pressured us into everything. My parents never knew when I had a VCE exam. They never said to me, "I have to go and study." I did it because, you know, I had to do it, and they gave me the opportunity, but they gave me also the responsibility to run my life. And, you know, for me, I thought it was the best upbringing that I could ever imagine. I've tried to follow that. And, you know, I've been very lucky, if you like, that I've had somebody that really taught me the really important values, and a strong liberal home, which is, you know, that goes without saying. But
responsibilities taught,
responsibilities. You know, we had a lot of political debate and stuff like that at home, but, you know, in a good way around the kitchen table. And nothing was, there was never no in our family. There was never no. If I wanted to try something, my brother and sister wanted to try something, we would. And Mum and Dad would be there. They'd say, "Yep, no problems." I had a market stall at about the age of 12, and my dad would drive me to the South Melbourne market, drop me off and pick me up at the end, and then, you know, to load up all the stock in his car And then I'd be sitting counting all my coins from the market stall on Sunday watching some television show. And, you know, that was what we did, you know, like that was
which
a family
wasn't
thing.
Normal, like, for 14-year-olds to have their own business, but they just accepted that that's what you came up with and you wanted to do it, and they gave you that freedom.
They absolutely did. They absolutely did.
Were your parents both born in Australia? Or?
We're very, you know, long-standing Australian family, so, you know, we go back in the almost convict days in terms of... So... five generations. So it's a long-standing Australian family, and I think, you know, that's interesting in many ways. You compare that to Hayley's family, who were Holocaust survivors, and I've got to learn a lot about, you know, what she's experienced, and also the difficulties with her grandparents and what have you, in coming to a foreign country. So that's been an interesting balance for me and an interesting understanding as well.
And the other really interesting thing about that is that, in fact, you've kept that sense of Jewish neshama, that Yiddishkeit, because Israel is very, very important to you.
It is really important to me, but I've got to say it only became truly important, even though I went to Mount Scopus my whole life, it only truly became important to me when I went to university. And when I went to university, I was involved in, I got involved in student politics because we had and it was out in the West, so I was out at Footscray, which is now Victoria University, again near where my father's factory was. And I was probably the only Jew that was out there, and I was certainly the only liberal that was out there. and I was reading horrific things against Israel in the student newspaper. So I decided at that point, because it was really hit me, when I was in a bubble with all of my Jewish friends, you know, you don't see that. When you're in a campus with no Jews around you and you've got this really attacks on Israel in the student newspaper, you want to do something about it. And that's what got me motivated and got me to a point of actually doing something about it. I ran a ticket to take over the student union on three very simple policies. The policies were more beer, more barbecues and more bands. And with that, we got 17 of 18 positions elected through the more beer, barbecue and band scenario, and we had the best parties on campus for the next 3 years. Our students loved us. We brought bands in from everywhere, and we shut down the student newspaper, and we got people to enjoy campus life, not to run a political agenda, which was being done before.
That is so awesome. And that was the day way before they started talking about strategic planning or strategy. You just worked it out yourself.
Pretty simple, yeah. Find out what the people want and give it to them. Yeah, that was pretty simple back then.
And that probably helps today as well.
Yeah, you're probably right. Politics, I think politics has probably become a little bit too complicated and I think, you know, in fairness, if you have a look at some of the leaders that have been successful from, you know, Boris Johnson to Trump to ScoMo, you know, like it's getting back to basics of, you know, what are the things that really people are needing, you know, to ensure their life's okay, a job, education, you know, the very, very basics, and how can you deliver that without overcomplicating it, which I think sometimes we do.
And the other aspect which you have is that entrepreneurial and business, not only spirit, but successful background, because I think that's really important too, taking responsibility for bringing in your own income through a business as opposed to being on a job and getting a wage or a salary. So bringing that into politics is huge.
I think that's something that I am very proud to bring to the parliament, and I think people have to have diverse skills into the parliament. I know we can talk about some of my business I've been involved in later, but I think particularly that I've always said this, one of the biggest failings of our political system is that we don't have people from diverse backgrounds into our parliament. And I'm a very strong advocate of we should have, you know, doctors, lawyers, teachers, radio presenters, DJs, whatever it may be, bring them in to be able to give real-life experience about what's happening on the ground so they can give positive contributions and real-life contributions and not have somebody that has just had a political career and can only talk politics and not talk people.
Just curious, how did you get into your first business of candle making?
Oh, so it was, cosmetics and stuff. So the very first way I got involved in that was I used to buy and sell stuff at auctions. I called myself a stockbroker, but buying stock of distressed stock, not actually stocks on the market. And I got hold of some cosmetic bags. And I went to Priceline, and Priceline purchased all of these cosmetic bags off me. And then I went looking around at auctions for anything I could buy in the toiletries to sell them to Priceline. Found a cosmetics manufacturer, and then I developed up my own range of skincare and toiletries, of which I sold to Kmart. Just an idea.
Developed your own? I mean, was it a kitchen table thing?
It was literally. I found a designer that I said, if you know, I get this order, I'll be able to pay you. Would you be able to help work with me? And she said, yep. So we did it all on spec. I went, you know, literally filling other people's bottles into different bottles and packages and putting labels on bottles. And the focus around this product was, and it was probably 20 years ahead of its time, it was environmental product, very much all about helping the environment. We gave 10% of our profits to environment causes and helping long-term unemployed and homeless youth.
Back then.
So it was all cause-related stuff, and we ended up turning it into a $6 million a year business. We provided work for charities. We helped ARDOC, which I became very involved with ARDOC after that. We gave boats away for dolphin research to research in Port Phillip Bay. I employed a lot of homeless and long-term people into a factory in Moorabbin. I ended up having 50 staff. And that was started literally from $500 and an idea and nothing more.
That is such a phenomenal success story. Walk me through this business of integrating people into the workforce that may not have had other opportunities, and also giving 10% or whatever it was to the charities, and then going on the board of ARDOC. Walk me through it in terms of, you're a businessman, you're getting a business going. What place was that always a first priority, or you started doing things and saw the opportunity?
So interesting. I think you've got to have something that's very consistent, a strategy that's very consistent with, you know, a vision and a values of things. And for me, ironically, I started with the charity and the idea first of the course. So I really started interviewing what charities I wanted to get involved in before we even produced the first lot of product. So, you know, I knew that I wanted to make a product for young people, and I knew that I wanted to help other young people with that product. So that's where I started. And I interviewed Kathy Hilton at the very beginning, saying, this is what I want to do, and I want to be able to give money to ARDOC, and what do you think? And she said, that'd be great, and I want to give some toiletries to start with, and then I'd want to help with some other stuff. We ended up paying the rent for their referral centre, and I got involved in the board, and we did a whole range of stuff. But, you know, it was the vision first and understanding what we were going to do. And then when we started producing the product, I said, well, you know, we just can't, we've got to walk the talk. So I want to be able to employ people, not just help in a distant way, but employ people that are finding it tough.
David, it sounds like charity part of it was almost as important as the actual business.
More important than the business. So I think, and that's why I've ended up in politics, is because for me it wasn't so much the business, but it was the cause, and it was helping people. And that's why this is a bigger way of me being able to do it through the politics. And it was always, even though I didn't necessarily think I was going to be destined to do this, it was always a natural path that I could pursue. But for me, it was, and I had business partners, but they just followed this path that I was on. I was like, this is what we've got to do. And, you know, the funniest story is we were developing up a marine range. And again, I interviewed the Dolphin Research Project, which is still around. Jeff Weir, who's the executive director still, is 20 years on. And Jeff came to me and said, yep, you know, we'd love you to help us. I said, that's great. I said, we'll give 10 cents of every product to the Dolphin Research Project. He said, that's brilliant. He said, but we've got a real problem at the moment. We need a boat to do our research. And the current boat is a dinghy that we pump up each time, and it doesn't survive. And we need a real proper boat to do it. And I said, how much was it? And this was probably 20 years ago. And he said to me, oh, it's about $25,000. And I said, fine, we'll get you the boat. And I got my credit card and two credit cards, and I put the boat on two credit cards, and we bought the boat before we produced the first product. And my business partner said, you are absolutely crazy. What are you doing? And I said, we've got to strive for this, and if we don't believe it, we're not going to be successful, and that's got to be the vision. We do this stuff, and we did it, and we were successful because of that. And our staff that were involved were also very, very focused on, and I see the staff today that have gone on that never got a break, that, you know, were always judged, and we got them in, you know, they felt part of a family. We had a guy that was coming in mowing the lawns on the weekend, and I had no idea how our lawns were being mowed. And I kept asking, and I came in one weekend, and there was Duncan, who was our forklift driver, borrowed a lawnmower to mow the lawns because he wanted pride in his place.
Wow.
Wasn't paid for it, but he did it on his day off. And that was kind of the culture that we developed. And this was 20 years ago, before a lot of this stuff. So, yeah, I probably in that way was a bit ahead of my time in the stuff. But I think the problems that we've got today are no different than the problems we had yesterday, probably even more, particularly with our youth. And I think that's where we've got some real challenges. And that's where particularly me and my focus within the Liberal Party, because I think the one thing that we don't get credit for, people say as Liberals we're good economic managers and all the rest of us, but they don't realise that we have a heart and we care. And most of us Liberals have got involved in politics because we have a heart and because we care, and not because of the money or because of anything else. And so I think that's where I want to spend my time in the future, is being able to do some of the caring stuff, compassionate stuff, to make that difference.
And here's part of the issue as well, because your story is amazingly inspiring to so many people, and especially that culture of giving back. Now, I personally know some people who are extremely successful businessmen, and they have that culture within their businesses, but they don't want to talk about it. They don't want to let people know about it, because it's something they do from their heart. It's not something they want credit for, but they have that same kind of loyalty and pride from their employees, and it's a wonderful place to work, and they don't turn over many people.
Yeah, and that's a key. I think that, you know, and also particularly that's something that we've been very successful of in the Jewish community as well. You know, that's a lot of people base that premise of what they do. So I think that's a really, really important thing. It needs to be done more. I think for me, I did it. You know, I was very visible in what we did because I wanted people to come on board with me. I wanted to drive almost like a movement. And I felt that if people were buying something, they could be proud that it actually meant something. You know, 20 years ago, we had a website on the front of our cosmetic bottle saying, you know, go and visit the website. And it wasn't selling anything, but it was talking about dolphins in Port Phillip Bay and stillbirth babies, you know, that needed, you know, families that needed support from that, and homeless kids and shelters and all that stuff. That's what we were selling. We were selling the helping individuals, not necessarily selling toiletries in a cosmetics bottle.
Mm. I'm just thinking perhaps the way to solve that a little bit and also share it is to have a website where people who work for companies like yours can go on the website, and without even mentioning the company name, because the owners don't want to do that, just talk about the wonderful conditions they have and some of the great things that happen within their workplace.
Look, absolutely. And I think that's, again, probably one of the issues with the union movement. You know, like, unions used to be all about focusing on helping people, which is what they should be doing. But, you know, when we're seeing it almost driving a wedge between employee and employer, ultimately to the detriment of a lot of businesses that just can't survive through a whole range of pressures that they deal with, then that's not good for anybody. So, and I remember that I used to have, you know, we used to have morning tea and lunch outside the front of the factory. A little van would pull up and you'd get your pies and whatever, and you'd sit around with the staff and everyone would eat together. The union representative came to me one time when I was doing that and basically said, I want to talk to the staff. And I said, no problems, go for it. And he said, without you. And I'm like, well, you know, I'm just part of the team here, you know, I'm not... And he said, no, you can't be here. And eventually I had to leave so he could spend the next hour just saying how bad your boss is. And my staff didn't want to borrow that, and they didn't listen. And that ended up leading to the union at that time boycotting our product, so we couldn't get our products unloaded from Kmart over Christmas. And it was almost going to bankrupt our business until such time as I literally had to pay for a couple of union memberships in my factory to make them go away. So they were not going to let go until they got a couple of delegates from the... And that's the way they operated back then. And that's not the way to operate with anybody. You know, like, we, our staff, we had profit share. We gave 10% of another 10% of our profits to the staff. I had my accountant come in and actually run through what a balance sheet and everything was to educate our staff so they could understand how to read balance sheets and profit and loss statements. So we were all about helping others. Yet, you know, we had others that had different agendas.
Yeah, so you've got to get that culture out there more.
Yeah, it doesn't.
And my friend also, this friend that I know, also provides free hot lunches for the staff, like proper chef hot-cooked meals and also profit share and stuff
terrific.
That. So it's a wonderful thing. David, I get the feeling from you, and I sometimes feel that this positivity thing has become part of my way of life. So the way, and I'm getting a lot of this from you. Most people have ups and downs, and I certainly do, but there's always a positive around. I'm not trying to get anything negative that's happened, but does it come as an affront to you when people are negative?
Oh, look, I can understand. Look, again, one of the horrific things in our society at the moment is the amount of depression that's around. You know, like my father suffered from depression, ironically, with all of his positivity that he had, and he was the life of the party everywhere that he went. But when he retired, and he retired from business, he retired from community life as well, he had nothing to fill that gap. And so he became a bit of a recluse, and it kind of sent him into did in a depression state. And that was horrible to see such a big man, larger than life, kind of really fall into a shell. So that worries me, I've got to say, you know.
How did you deal with that?
It was horrific. I, you know, cared for him right up until the end, and it really hurt. And it hurts me to this day that he's not here and to see that change. And I think a lot of men, particularly men, experience that because they don't have the social circles and they don't have the extracurricular activities outside of work. And, you know, then invariably in many instances that kind of negative stuff creeps in. I've always been really, really positive. And, yeah, things get me down and certainly nothing always goes your way. But I find ways to kind of just push it back and say move on. I really believe in not having broigus with anybody. You know, I try to kind of, you know, deal with something because I feel like you end up owning it yourself. If you get angry at others, then you end up the worst owning it.
So 100%.
I just try and fix and settle everything that I possibly can. When I'm feeling just a little bit, you know, stressed, because I do get stressed, there's no question in this job, I go and have a swim. And when I've had a swim, and I know my Auntie Rosalie's a big swimmer as well, and my dad was too, and just getting in the pool, it just kind of takes all of that away. And, you know, try and find some exercise or something just to do, just to take off that stress. And, of course, family also can help as well. But, you know, like you deal with what you deal with.
That's a great couple of different ways of relieving stress. Really fabulous, especially knowing that it works for you. But also your first business as a DJ was a fun business. You get to party.
Loved it. So my DJ, and that's still what I'm probably the most known for outside of politics in the community. There's not a day goes by when people talk to me about the DJing days and also want me to come and do a guest appearance at some school reunion or what have you. I started that back at 17. Again, it was at Scopus. A lot of my friends were turning 18. They wanted to have parties. Actually, before that, I was working as a waiter at the President in Queen's Road. And I noticed that there was a DJ there, and while I was running around collecting plates and being running around like a maniac, this guy was enjoying a meal and playing some music and just having fun. And I went to him and I said, gee whiz, how do you get into that? And he told me, and he said, do you want to come down? And so I went down. After, you know, five or six times volunteering as doing the DJ thing, he said, you can go out and do your own party. So, and that was Andrew Noble, which was very big at the time.
Oh, wow.
So I ended up, I worked, you know, about 3 months for him, and then I set up my own thing, and it was very successful. And I DJed for about 20 years, and I did thousands of parties, and I loved my music. I still love my music. It's something that I also de-stress from, in terms of just listening to music.
Takes you away into another place.
Takes you away, and I think, you know, music is a really good relief for everybody.
I actually DJed at the Grosvenor Hotel down here in Brighton when I was about 17. I know it was 17 because my mother had
too.
To drop me off and I got picked up.
Yeah, I did a few parties.
But I did radio training with Lee Murray and he got me that job as a DJ. It was really, really fun.
Yeah.
And when you've got that to fall back on, it really is a wonderful thing because music can take you away anywhere. And you met your wife at one of these parties as well and got to really see what her mettle was because...
It was at her niece's bat mitzvah and she came up and started talking to me at the party. And at the end, I was packing up, and she was helping me packing up the speakers and everything. I thought, oh, this is pretty good here. You know, she's helping me. She must be interested. And of course, because of her niece's bat mitzvah, her father and mother were there as well. And her father could see this interaction between her and I and was a little bit concerned that, you know, she's spending too much time with the DJ. So he came over and was helping me pack up as well to get me out the door. And then meanwhile, you know, Hayley's saying, oh, what are you doing afterwards and whatever else. So yeah, it was from that little, meet that it kind of flourished into a couple of dates. And our dates, because every weekend I worked, so Hayley would come along to the parties. And funnily enough, I only caught up with some people at one of the UIA volunteer nights a few nights ago, and they reminisced with me, and they said to me, we used to remember you at all the parties, and we also remembered Hayley there with you. You know, you'd have your little table set to the side, you'd have a meal like it was a date, and you were taking her for a date, and then you'd be off doing the party. And she did. She spent a lot of time with me at those parties.
And I've got to tell you, you guys still look like you're dating. I mean, when I've seen you out and about. I haven't played any of your favourite music because this has been so fascinating. So let's just get one song in at least. Remember and Earth, Wind and Fire.
Local people.
J-Air, 87.8 FM.
And welcome back to Lily High on Life with David Southwick. David, great song. Tell us why that's one of your favourites.
Well, it's one of my favourites, September, which is in the, and in the words, it's on the 21st night of September, the Four Seasons. And that's actually the birth date of my son, our son Tyler. And so every time we hear the song, we just think of, you know, that was our firstborn, and it's a party song. And so it does kind of bring back a lot of really good memories.
Very cool. Do you remember what it was like when he first came out and you first held him for the first time?
Oh, yeah, it seems like so long ago. But, yeah, no, I do. It was a very, very special time. It was interesting because obviously your first child is, you know, we don't know what to expect, and it's very, very daunting. You contrast that with the second one with Paige, which she's 2 years younger, and 30th of October, her birthday. And when Hayley was giving birth with Paige, we actually had Parliament on TV. And I was watching, it was then the Senate, federal Senate, and Rod Kemp was talking about, who was the Minister for Sport, and I remember seeing his speech. So he was talking about changes to regulations in sport. So I was busy, you know, tuned in, and I wasn't, back then I wasn't actually a politician, but certainly, you know, interested, if you like, because it was...
what a wife you've got.
So she was saying, you know, get that bloody thing off the TV. So there you go.
That's just absolutely gorgeous. And the kids now, they're 14 and...
15 and 17. 17. So Paige is 15, Tyler's 17. Tyler's doing his year 12, Paige year 10.
Paige interested in politics too?
Yeah, look, Paige has certainly been around it, and she understands it, you know, really, really well. Paige is more interested in the entrepreneurship side, which is really, really good. So a few years back, she's going to hate me telling you this, but we were travelling over the West Gate Bridge, and, you know, next to the casino, there's this gold building. I still don't know what it is, but it's just a gold, big gold building. And she said, "You see that building, Dad?" I said, "Yeah." And she says, "I want one of those when I'm older." I said, "Oh, okay, fair enough." And she said, "Yeah, what do you want for?" She said, "Well, that will be my business. I'm going to have heaps of staff working for me. And, you know, we're going to be producing something really good." And I said, "You know what?" She said, "No, I don't know." But, you know, she's kind of got this vision already of what she wants to do. So every time she does something well, we remind her that, you know, it's one step closer towards the goal building. So
absolutely awesome. So you're obviously doing something right, the two of you.
We are an absolute very, very close family. And, And all of us, and even though the kids will fight like all kids do, they've got one another's back, and it's great, and they share one another's passion.
You obviously encourage them in a very productive kind of way. I just want to ask you, before you actually became a Member of Parliament, you ran twice and you didn't win. What was that like,
so
not
third
succeeding?
Time, third time lucky. So 2004, I stood against Michael Danby for what was Melbourne Ports back then, and then in 2006, I stood in the upper house for the Southern Region, and I lost by only a few hundred votes out of 900,000 votes, because it's a whole region. And then third time was Caulfield. Each time is really, really grueling. It's very hard to actually explain how confronting it is, particularly for the family. And, you know, people think, oh, it's great because, you know, someone will pay you and you just keep doing what you're doing. You basically stop what you're doing. And for about 12 months, you campaign without any job. And not only without being paid, but you actually then have to fundraise to fund your campaign. So you basically put your life on hold. And luckily, I had some success with my businesses to be able to do that. But, you know, 12 months of literally just working day and night, hoping that you would be successful. And then the result comes out and you lose. And then you've got to confront the community the very next day, and it's really, really tough,
so
particularly for the family. Really,
really
tough.
So it's not just dealing with your disappointment, you're dealing with your family's disappointment and the community disappointment as well, but then you go do it again.
Yeah, and look, you know, the second time was probably, for me, it hurt the most, but was the biggest lesson. So in the second time, and I won't mention names, but there was somebody who was quite a formidable opponent that ended up getting up over me. And, you know, he basically didn't... And we went to the exhibition centre and all the votes were counted over 2 weeks, and it was really close, so no one knew who was going to win. And it was really up to a push of a button on a computer. Anyway, so He hadn't turned up until after the result. I'm standing around. They push up the button. I lose. He wins. He comes into the room. And I had Liberal people around me, and they said, "You don't need to be around this. Come on, let's go." And I actually turned to them and said, "I do need to be around this." And I shook everybody's hand in the room, and I remembered that day as clear as it was yesterday. And it hurt as much as I can possibly fathom in terms of just how tough that was. But when I left that room, I said, "I'm going to do this again, and next time I'm going to win. And there will be no ifs or buts in terms of that." So I was really, really determined. And I think that's what gave me the motivation and the drive. When Helen Shardy said that she was going to retire from Caulfield, I literally put my hand up the next day and said, "I am going to be Helen's replacement." I rang all of the delegates in Caulfield and I said, "I want that seat." And thankfully, no one challenged me, which is unusual for a relatively safe seat back then. But I think people knew that I was really determined, and I'd had a couple of goes at it, and you know that I was the one that was the best suited for the job.
We're so glad that you did go for it the third time. But for me, that mindset where you decided it wasn't about how you were feeling, it wasn't about any disappointment, it was about you knowing what you wanted and you knowing what you wanted to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And look, I do come back, and I think with this job, disappointment, again, I think you can handle most things as a politician. You learn to do that. It's very confronting. People will tell you exactly what they think, what they feel. But the difficulty thing is, it is very, very visible in everything that you do. And when there's ups and there's downs, but when there's downs, you know, when things don't necessarily go your way, your family are very, very exposed. And that's, you know, I'm very thankful that they've always been with me, always been supportive and understand, you know, what we're doing and what the game is, what the plan is, you know, in terms of the long-term game of being elected and doing the different things that we want to achieve. So I'm lucky with that.
And it really is just all perspective. Change your attitude, change your life.
Absolutely.
One of your choices was to hang your head and go back into a cave and get depressed.
Yep.
But you made a choice not to do that, and it's about making choices. Just in the few minutes that we've got left, tell me about the things you're currently working on that you're the most excited about.
Yeah, there's lots happening. I mean, in the Jewish community specifically, we've had the Achfa thing, which is the anti-Semitic materials that in the VCE, and we're calling on the organisation to make a public apology and to ensure that the materials don't this kind of thing doesn't happen again. And James Kennard, the principal of Mount Scope, has been very, very strong on this, and it's been really good working with him on some of the advocacy work. In terms of more broadly, Jewish education in the community is a real issue in terms of affordability of Jewish education. So it's one of the issues that I want to do some more work on and see what we can do in terms of helping around that particular thing, the growing issues around anti-Semitism. There's a lot in terms of the community. More broadly, I mean, I've got police and corrections as my areas of responsibility. Real issues around youth crime. It's getting horrific, and it goes back to some of the things I used to do, which were spoken about earlier. They're the things that I really want to change. Our prisons are completely full. It costs $1 million to build a new bed, $130,000 a year to keep somebody in jail. It's just ridiculous. We need other ways and other solutions, and they're the things that I'm trying to look at, better ways to do things, and particularly in that justice area, in the youth, in law and order, there are areas that are very, very important to me. And a fair go, and obviously rebuilding the party to a point where we win the next election in 2022, which, you know, that will be my focus.
Absolutely. And then you were also telling me when we spoke the other week that in terms of immigration, there's a really amazing program that Israel has for its immigrants that might be a good idea for us too.
Yeah, so again, this has been UIA largely led in terms of their absorption centres, particularly with a lot of the African and Ethiopian immigrants that have come through, where they learn the culture, they learn things in terms of the language and even buying things in supermarkets and everything. So by the time they actually leave, they're job ready and they're able to integrate properly into society. One of our issues here is we bring people into the country, but we don't invest in them once they're here. So my focus really is around what are we going to do once we get somebody here, and we should commit from every dollar it is might be bringing them here, invest in them when they're here, because then we're going to get a lot better results in the long term. And I think a lot of people have come from war-torn countries that have got real complex issues, and no one's really tackled that. No one's given them those support and those ways forward. I know particularly with a lot of in the African community, a lot of the youth that are kind of have gone into the crime stuff, their parents are completely horrified and don't know how to handle it. They're the kinds of things we've got to do to stop us from having a generation of crime and hardened criminals in the future. So there's a lot of work to be done around that, and there's some of the areas I'm doing a lot of work in terms of very different ethnic groups and to try and alleviate those issues. I love this state, I love this country, and I love where I live, and that's why I do what I do, and I want to make it the best place for all of us.
And really, you can feel the passion. You're here in the studio, 7 o'clock at night, and you can still feel the passion, the energy, and the love for what you do. So, as we say, kola kavod, David, and thank you so much for everything that you do and you continue to do.
Thank you, Lily.